County since 2009. She began her legal career as an assistant district attorney at the Shawnee County District Attorney's Office. For 2 years, she handled all the cases involving sex offenses, including prostitution, pornography, rape, and aggravated indecent liberties with minors. In 1981, she moved to her hometown of Independence, Kansas to become assistant county attorney. In 1985, she was the first woman elected as county attorney. After a 4-year term, she entered private practice with an emphasis on family law, the enforcement and collection of child support, and criminal defense. After practicing in Independence for over 25 years, she relocated to her practice in Lawrence and was of counsel with the law office of David Brown, where her practice was concentration on family law, non-traditional family law, criminal law, and appellate practice. She obtained her JD from Washburn in 1978. She is a member of an enormous number of committees, which I will not name because there are lots and lots of them. She has received the Kansas Bar Association Outstanding Service Award, Kansas Bar Association Recognition for Pro Bono Commitment, the Synopsis International Independence Women Helping Women Award, Women of the Year Award from the Business and Professional Women's Association, and the NOSO, is the Alumni Women's Honor Society at Washburn University, which I believe you got this year.
I did, April.
Which is a big, big deal. It means its motto is "Non Novus Solum," not for ourselves alone. The organization recognizes exceptional Washburn women based on their intelligence, creativity, personality, scholarship, leadership, moral integrity, community involvement, and accomplishment. So welcome her, and she will introduce everyone.
To the Lawrence League of Women Voters, thank you very much for asking us to be here tonight. I will be the moderator, but the truly informative people will be Justice Marla Luckert and Justice Carol Beier. I'd like to start, first of all, thanking you for coming out. It shows that you want to be informed voters, and this is one way to get that information. And so I'd like to start first just so you can get to know these two justices.
life. I went to Catholic schools there in Wyandotte County and ended up finishing my undergraduate work at the University of Kansas, right here in Lawrence. I was a journalism major. One of the big influences on me growing up, I was in high school during Watergate, and I remember watching my dad and how disillusioned he was by that whole situation and by the performance of lip service in that situation. And of course, some of the heroes in that story were the journalists. And so that really led me to want to be a newspaper woman. And that was, in fact, my first career. After I finished journalism school here, I went to work at the Kansas City Times and worked there for a while. After a couple of years, though, as much as I liked that business, I thought, I think maybe I'd like to be an actor rather than a storybook. And so I went back to law school, again here at the University of Kansas, which is where I got my JD in 1985. Later, I got another law degree at the University of Virginia. But that's where my educational background is. I spent the first year of law school working for a federal judge, and then spent 2.5 years in Washington, D.C., first at the National Women's Law Center, at a fellowship to Georgetown Law Center, and then at a large firm there, right at White Collar Criminal Defense Work. At that point, I decided to marry one of the white-haired guys wandering around here. I don't know where he went. My husband's here with me tonight. And we moved to Wichita, and that's where I spent most of my practice years, aside from 1 year I spent here in Lawrence in the teaching at the University of Kansas Law School. So that's my background. My practice was all litigation, no transaction work, both trial and appellate practice, a lot of different areas, some commercial, a little bit of domestic. I was fortunate. In a big firm, normal people specialize, but I was kind of lucky. I got to do quite a few different types of cases. I joined up, like Marla, I was appointed to two different courts by two different governors. I joined the Court of Appeals with Deb's husband, Jerry Elliott, one of my dear friends, in 2000. In fact, I'm pretty sure Jerry was one of the people who called me and said, you should apply for this. So I joined the Court of Appeals in February 2000, served there for 3.5 years, and then moved up to the Supreme Court in 2003. Governor Graves appointed the Court of Appeals, and then governors of those to the Kansas Supreme Court.
Well, while you're still standing, why don't you tell us what it was that caused you to decide to put your name in as a nominee for the Supreme Court?
Really, there are a couple of reasons. I already mentioned that I kind of wanted to be an actor. I was attracted to the job I have now, in part because I wanted to be in the thick of it. But also, the intellectual challenge is very appealing to me. I'm just one of those people who really likes school and likes trying to figure out a knotty legal issue or problem. So that was very interesting to me. The Court of Appeals certainly has its share of those kinds of cases, but in the Kansas Supreme Court, pretty much every case fits that description. It operates like a lot of funnels, and as they funnel to us, they get more and more complex and more difficult. And I like that intellectual challenge. But really, overall, it's about public service. It's just kind of part of my DNA. Both of my parents were very motivated to be community workers and volunteers in addition to their professions and their home life. And it was just something that I thought, as one of my partners did, said when I left the firm, I just thought it was something you were supposed to do when you grew up. So when I grew up, I went back to it.
Justice Luckert, can you tell us what attracted you to put your name in for as a nominee for this Kansas Supreme Court?
Well, really, most of the reasons that Carol has mentioned are very important to me as well. A commitment to public service, certainly, and a commitment to the service of my profession as well. I'm very dedicated to that. But I do have to say that I don't know if those things on their own would have motivated me. I really like being a trial court judge, but I'll mention this because I know this has been a very important issue for the League of Women Voters, and that's diversity. As you might guess, in the 90s when I became a trial court judge, there were no trial court. There were no women in Cheyenne County on the trial court bench. Jean Shepherd, you have a longer history here with Jean, and there were a few scattered around, but people came to me and they said, we need women. We need bench to reflect the community. And that frankly was very motivating to me. And then the same thing, when it was, there were an opening on the Supreme Court, people came to me again and kind of made the same pitch. And I do believe strongly that all of us have a need to work towards ensuring that we have a diverse bench that does reflect our communities.
Keep standing. I'm going to give you the job of explaining what the process you had to go through in order to be selected by the, how did you make an actually get to the governor to be selected for the Supreme Court?
Kansas has a unique system of having two ways of becoming a judge. And it varies depending on where you live, how you become a district court judge. It happened in the 1950s that our Constitution was amended to move away from elected judges to judges who became judges through the merit selection process. And kind of the political compromise of having that happen was that in the Constitution, the Kansas Supreme Court became a court that would be selected through the merit selection process. But at the local level, they would leave it to the 31 judicial districts in our state for the local districts to decide whether they would elect their judges or use the merit selection process. And in Lawrence, you chose and have continued to use the merit selection process. And if you're not familiar with that, just to kind of compare and contrast that with the statewide system, there is a local nominating commission with non-attorneys who are appointed by your county commissioners, and then attorneys who are selected by members, the licensed attorneys who practice in Douglas County. And then that commission sends out a notice to all attorneys saying, we have an opening, any and every one of you are allowed to apply. At the statewide level, it's the same sort of thing, except that the commission comes from the entire state. The governor appoints the four non-lawyers, and they come from each of the congressional districts. And then the attorneys in the state elect the attorney members. And when there's an opening, they send out a notice to 11,000 attorneys across the state, say, whoever you are, wherever you are, you're eligible, you can apply for this position. When they receive the applications, which are require an incredible amount of information, they want your grades, they want your bank accounts, they want your tax returns, they want your financial statements, they want names of people that you have tried cases against, they want people, you judges you have appeared in front of. They check out everything. A friend of ours likes to tell the story that when she applied, she was a little embarrassed when one of the questions that was asked was, how did you get a C in high school representative? And I can tell you that for me, I didn't have that question, but I was shocked when one of the lay members asked me a question about a passage, because one of the things you do is keep your writing, things you've written. And they asked about something I had written like almost 10 years before, and wanted to know why I had met by this and why I had said it. And I think I just use those examples to tell you that it's a very extensive vetting process. At the Supreme Court level, they then send two or three names to the governor for appointment. The governor makes the selection. As we've mentioned, if you saw from our history, we both have been appointed to a board by a Republican and by a Democrat. The concept of the merit selection system is that it's non-partisan, which means it's not supposed to be political. Once you are appointed, at the next general election, will be on the ballot. Voters are probably used to that end of the ballot where you see the question. In my case, it would be, shall Marla Luckert be retained in office? And you are given the option to vote yes or no. If 50% of you would say no, I would be
I'll get back to her in a second. But the trial court is where witnesses come and testify, juries are seated, and help decide the facts in cases, that sort of thing. We sit on the appellate court, and we happen to sit on the highest appellate court in Kansas. We also have the Court of Appeals, 14 judges on the Court of Appeals. And our cases come to us when someone's unhappy with the result, either in district court or in the Court of Appeals, or possibly both. And they can come to us one of three ways. Our court handles what we call original actions, which are cases that are filed in our court in the first instance. Those are rare, relatively rare, and they tend to fall into a category of highly technical legal term, hair on fire. Wichita marijuana ordinance was one such case. It needed to be decided very quickly, it needed to be decided definitively, and it came straight to us. So that we do original actions. But most of our cases come to us one of two ways. There are certain types of cases, very serious crimes are an example, and the domain cases are an example, that come directly to us from Sally's court and other courts like hers around the state. And then the other category come to us by way of a petition for review process. And those cases have come through the Court of Appeals. One party or the other is still unhappy with the ruling, and so they file a document asking us to consider the case. So I guess the basic point is that we're different from the trial court in that we sit all seven of us together on every case. We only talk to the lawyers. So we just sit, we prepare, we read up on the case, we read the record and briefs and memos prepared by staff, and then we come to our courtroom and the lawyers come and they make arguments to us and we ask them questions. So that's different. The other difference is, obviously, when Sally's ready to make a decision, the only person she needs to consult is herself. Whereas on our court, if you don't have three other people who agree with you, you don't have four out of seven, and your position will be in the minority. So after we hear oral argument, we return to our conference room, and we sit that very afternoon and come to at least a tentative agreement on how the case is going to be decided. And then we draft opinions. I imagine we'll have some discussion of that at some point.
Well, I was going to ask while standing up. If you go to the law books and you pull out a case, oftentimes there's only one judge's name there on the case, and then it goes on for anywhere from two pages to many pages. So if only your name is there, does that mean you just have to decide it all by yourself?
No.
Okay.
It does not mean that. This is a pretty critical point as well. They're called opinions, but don't be misled by that. When we talk about opinions in our daily life, we mean, well, that's just your opinion. That's what you think. It may or may not have any validity. It may or may not have any facts to back it up, etc. But that's just a term of art in the law. We call them opinions. That just means it's a written decision of the court. But that name you see appearing is just the person who really is kind of the scrivener for the majority of the court, and frequently a unanimous court. I think we tend to be unanimous far more often than we tend to have separate opinions. But that means that at least four members of the court agree on not only the decision, the ultimate outcome, but the reasoning to get to that outcome. And that's what that person is. They're the scribe. They're not the person who just came up with the answer by themselves. That would really make our lives easier, but it's not the way that it works.
Justice Luckert, since these cases come to you, and obviously Justice Beier said we don't always agree, how do you all get along if you're arguing about what the ultimate decision should be, or even though you may agree on the ultimate decision, you don't agree on the legal reasoning to arrive at that decision? How is it that you
actually, they're not. They're what
answer is it depends on the case, but Justice Beier, can you tell everybody about what you think the average case takes and what is the longest period of time taking to get a case decided?
Our decision time, we're always working to improve it, and we're far from perfect. Some cases can be written up shortly after conference, and if there's no real controversy over the legal points, if they're it's fairly simple, straightforward, perhaps there's only one legal issue to address, some of those cases can be disposed of pretty quickly. And there are certain types of cases that we are bound by law and by rule to expedite as quickly as possible. But other cases can be very difficult to resolve. Either they may have many, many issues. Death penalty cases are certainly an example of that. They often have dozens and dozens of issues raised. It's just the nature of the beast. When you have a punishment that's irrevocable, then lawyers raise every possible issue they can raise. That's the way litigation in that area is done. So those cases take a particularly large amount of time sometimes, and certainly a large amount of resources. We've estimated just at the Supreme Court level that those types of cases take 20 times the resources of an ordinary even first-degree murder case. But first-degree murder cases often will have numerous issues, and they can be complex. Certainly, multi-party civil litigation can take quite a long time. Our goal is always to accelerate the pace of decision, but it isn't always easy to do. I mentioned that we conference immediately after we arrive at a tentative decision. I say tentative for a very deliberate reason. Once we have that tentative decision and it's determined who's going to write the opinion, that person returns to his or her chambers and begins to do so. But even once that opinion has been drafted, then it will circulate to all the other members of the court. It will not be filed until everyone is satisfied that their view is represented accurately and that the language is acceptable to them. So it does happen, not all the time certainly, but it does happen that once that opinion is in circulation, perhaps the dissenter is particularly persuasive and the votes have changed. So that circulation process also adds to the amount of time it takes. So it can be anywhere from a few weeks to several months or even a few rare, very rare cases, I think, over a year.
Well, Justice Luckert, if I want to know what you're doing on a Friday, is there any way I can find that out?
You certainly can. Hopefully you've received a handout of some papers today. If you haven't, we'll try to get those to you. Doesn't look like everybody on this side has them, but on the front page of that, there are some web addresses, and one of those is our court website, which is kscourts.org. And that, at that website, you can do several things. You can, every Friday, see the decisions that are handed down on that day. This Friday, I think there'll be at least four decisions of our Supreme Court that will probably be filed on Friday. So you can go and you can read those. You can also, starting next Monday, we will be in court, in oral argument, in Topeka. You're certainly welcome to come there. But if you can't, you can go to that site and there's a link where you can watch us live in the oral argument. And if that's not convenient for you, don't worry. You can go back anytime you want and click on that link and watch an archived argument. So if you hear about a case and you're curious about the decision, you can go back and there will be active links with every decision that will take you to the oral argument and to the opinion, and you can read everything we do. Basically, it's a very transparent process. Our decisions will be detailed explanations of how we come to our decision. So it's not that we hope, we aren't leaving you a guess as to the rationale or the reason for that outcome. We try to make it very apparent to all the people of Kansas why we have reached the decision.
Annie, what's your favorite part of your job?
Well, I tell people that, fortunately, I love to read, because as you might guess, the volumes of reading you do is just my whole way of life. for the people of Kansas and the state of Kansas, and I'm very proud and honored to be able to do that.
And just as far as, what would you say is the most challenging part?
I think there are several challenging aspects, but I think probably the maybe the most consistently challenging is dealing with all the types of cases where my personal preference might differ from what is commanded by the law. And I think you all are getting a pretty good, at least with us going up and down that way, should be a pretty good picture tonight. We're human, and we have feelings like all other humans, and sympathies, and personal preferences. And so we're like all of you in that way. But our job and our oath to uphold the federal and state constitutions and to treat every litigant equally and to be bound by the rule of law requires us to do our very best to put our personal feelings aside and decide the cases on the facts before us and the applicable law. And that can be very challenging. That can be very challenging. I know when I first came to the Court of Appeals, having been a journalist, I thought, oh, I've sort of seen it all. I've done some criminal work in my practice. I thought it was pretty jaded, maybe even a little bit, about what went on in the world. But I've heard Marla say we see a lot of human tragedy pass through our courtroom, and it can be wearing, and it can be hard to remember our obligations sometimes, that even the person who is perhaps the least attracted litigant in some way is still entitled to the same rights as all the rest.
Well, Justice Luckert, I'm sure everybody here has kept up on the news and seen in the last couple of years that there have been close to 50 different pieces of legislation that have been attempted to be passed by our legislature to change the judiciary, either the selection process or the number or the power that the chief judge has or how they're selected. There's just been a barrage. How do you think that the public perception of you having to follow the rule of law fits in with this constant barrage of legislation to change things?
If anyone is a student of American history, you know that our country was founded really on the principle of fair and impartial courts. One of the usurpations of King George III was that he had not allowed the English system of fair and impartial courts to function in the colonies. So the colonists rebelled. And when they got to writing the Constitution, what is the first thing they said? We, the people, in order to establish a more perfect union, establish justice. It was critical to them. And it was so critical to them that they recognized that there had to be checks and balances and a system where the judiciary could be removed from the control of the other two branches of government. In fact, in the Federalist Papers, it's written that we have tyranny if we do not have the separation of the judiciary from the other two departments. And so they chose a system where judges were given life tenure so that they did not have to respond to politicians, the political pressures, the interest groups, even the electorate. As the movement, many of our states followed that initially, but as Western expansion occurred during the Jacksonian democracy, they decided they were going to elect everybody from the groundskeeper of the Capitol to the Supreme Court justices. And that created a tension that perhaps is not as strong, might not have been as strong in a different system, and eventually is what led to the merit selection process to try to remove some of the politics from the system. But anyway, to the point that the three branches of government were designed as a checks and balances, with the other fundamental understanding of that was that there would be tension. If those checks and balances are performing their job the way they're meant to be, there will be tension. One branch of government is telling the other branch of government, and our job is to perform the duty of judicial review, so that if a party brings to us a lawsuit that challenges the constitutionality of a statute, if the legislature has passed a statute that does not comply with the Kansas Constitution or the United States Constitution, our sworn constitutional duty is to declare either the act or a portion of that act unconstitutional. We don't do that lightly. We start with the presumption that it's constitutional, but bottom line, if it is, it is, and our duty, regardless of how popular that decision might be, is to declare it unconstitutional. And obviously, legislators don't usually like that. And thus, we have tension, and that tension manifests in a number of ways.
Do you mind if I, or Judge Pomey, excuse me, we've all been friends for a long time. Maybe, do you mind if I look for just a second? I just want to remind everybody maybe something we can forget in the clamor. And that is that these checks and balances that Marla just spoke of so eloquently, that they operate in both directions. And this is a fairly regular occurrence as well. So, for example, if we have a case that involves a statute that a party is relying on, and it's not a constitutional challenge, it's just how do we apply the statute, how do we interpret it? That's part of our job as well, and we move forward with that analysis, and we arrive at a result, and we explain ourselves. If the legislature disagrees with that interpretation, the next year, that statute can be amended or changed, and we can get a clearer statement of legislative intent. And if we have a clear statement of legislative intent, as we frequently say in our opinions, then it's not our job to do the policy judgment. It's the job of the legislature, and we leave that statute as it is and apply its clear language. Well, that's a form of check and balance on our power as well. So this is a two-way street, this tension. And as Marla said, only natural.
And we can add another step to that. If we rule it unconstitutional, the legislature can start the process of amending the Constitution. And that may sound like a hypothetical type of situation, but look at the United States Constitution. Of the 27 amendments to our United States Constitution, 7 of them can reasonably be said to overrule a court decision. And some of those have been made, Dred Scott, a decision that women shouldn't have a right to vote, decisions that said poll taxes were okay. And fortunately, through constitutional amendment, those decisions were changed.
Well, and one of the reasons we're all here, too, is because I think generally we've all felt that retention elections judges, me as a judge and the justices have been pretty much a non-issue, not very controversial or any advertising money put into those races. And either one of you want to just say what
And you're right, Judge Corney, retention is somewhat more controversial this year. And in part, Kansas is unfortunately part of a kind of a national trend. Certain special interest groups have realized that one way to affect their policy preferences is to undermine the fairness and impartiality and, of the court system, which is the backstop for minority views in our communities. You know, Marla mentioned the three branches. We have two that under our founders' grand, inspiring, inspired design are supposed to be politically created and continued and are supposed to be representative of majority will, but the courts are not. They're the exception to those two things. They're not supposed to be politically created or continued, and they're not supposed to be responsive to majority will or popular sentiment, but sometimes have to protect that unpopular point of view or unpopular sentiment. And really, I think what we have is a combination of this, some of this national trend of certain special interests getting involved, sometimes from out of state. Sometimes they're not even from the state in which they attempt to wield influence. So we have a little of that going on. And then we do have a lot of misunderstanding, lack of understanding, perhaps encouraged lack of understanding about how it's supposed to work and the fact that some decisions are going to be unpopular. It's just that, again, that natural design of our system. And so when people are unhappy with a particular decision, they're motivated to attack the court or individual members. Marla and I are one mind on this, I know, and I think our colleagues agree with us. We don't feel like this is a personal thing. We feel like it's a system issue. And that, you know, this happens to be the year that if Kansas want to protect the design, the founder's design, including the tensions that go with it, the healthy conversation we had across 10th Avenue and Topeka, then voters are going to need to stand up.
It's been said that under in social violence. Oh, and do you believe that the criminal justice system is beset by institutional racism, and if so, how do we address that?
The discussion of institutional racism, I think, is a very timely topic. Our whole country should be very involved in a discussion about what is implicit bias and how is it affecting everything from our policing system on through the judicial system. And it's something that we need to think about, be conscious of, and deal with. None of us can deny that if you look at the prison population, it is the demographics that show a racial tendencies. And so we need to understand what are the systemic causes in our society for that to be there. Are they economic? Are they social? Are they justice system? What are they? And I don't know if anybody has those answers, but as a nation, it's imperative that all of us be engaged in active discussion to try to find those answers. And as for the broader question, the system of justice is designed to punish the guilty, but protect the rights of every individual. And if we did not, through every court case, assure that everyone, regardless of what they are said to have done, is not given full due process of law, again, as a nation, we have failed in that command of our opening of the Constitution of justice. Because it is not vindictiveness, it is not vindication, it is justice. And that is our goal, and I'm not going to say that the system is perfect. I don't think anybody would make that assertion. But it is by far the best system that man has seen yet on Earth, and I think by far the best system currently being used anywhere in the world. And I think it's a system we can all be proud of as we continue to see ways to improve.
This is a two-part question. Actually, the second part is, what should Kansas do to make legal services more accessible? And which is what I see more as a district court judge than what you would run across. And should Kansas also convene an impartial panel of 9 persons to review the judicial system and make recommended changes?
I don't know which one you want me to start with. In terms of accessibility, this is an issue that we are ever concerned with. And I'll tell you that one of the biggest challenges the last few years has been shrinking resources. And frankly, an attitude that the court system, like many other functions in our society, should be user fee funded, rather than a basic expectation of our government that is funded by all of us as taxpayers. And this is something we really wrestle with at our level, because among the duties of the Supreme Court is administration of the judicial branch. And so we have to come up with a budget every year, one that is feasible and fundable, and frequently in the recent past, more and more of the burden of funding that budget is being shifted from state general fund money to user fees, so filing fees, marriage license fees, all kinds of court expenses. And so we are keenly aware of that. And we also are brought back to this issue annually because we have a grant that flows from our funding to Kansas Legal Services every year. And so we have many reminders every year too of just how tight their budget has become and how they're being squeezed for many areas in terms of civil access to civil justice of folks. And I'm sure that all of you read about the reimbursement rates for indigent criminal defense work. I think all of those are points, access points, that we are constantly aware of ever trying to improve. But frankly, the state resources overall are as constricted as they have been in the last few years.
I think that we're always open to good ideas. That's really the bottom line. We're always open to good ideas. We did have a kind of a top-to-bottom review. Was it 2014, I think, was when the... Marla, you served on the commission. Was it 2014, the date of the report? So, and that was a full year, year and a half study, Blue Ribbon Commission. And they really did a comprehensive report on the state of the Kansas judiciary. And those of you who are interested in this topic, the recommendations that were made for improvement, those things that we've worked on, we haven't gotten accomplished yet, but are continuing to work on that sort of thing, I really recommend, it's recommended reading. It is a readable document. Is it on our website? I'm not sure. It's on our web, in full, on our website. So again, you can go to kscourts.org and take a look at that. That's our most recent comprehensive study of the state of your judiciary. I don't see another fully comprehensive study like that on the immediate horizon, but every year we update some of the data that went into that foundation of that report through studies of efficiencies in our delivery of services, and whether people are in the right places, that sort of thing. Another one of the kind of ongoing projects that's coming into fruition is a more electronic delivery of our services, electronic facilitation of our services. We now have electronic filing in all of our courts. As you can imagine, you know what Kansas is like. We have some very urban areas and large swaths where there are not very many people, and consequently not as many cases. But we also have a mandate, a statutory mandate, that we have a judge in every county and certain items in every county. So trying to find an electronic way to facilitate better distribution of workload and that sort of thing is underway. There's another project we mentioned earlier, timeliness of decisions. I've been working on for the last year. The court appointed a committee on time standards, which was one of the Luckert Commission's recommendations. So we're kind of whittling away at all of those recommendations as resources permit. But I recommend that you take a look at that.
Very quickly, so everybody can see you, both of you.
Okay.
The question is, you're preaching to the choir here. Where else have you been?
Okay. Well, I'll be honest. We've been all over the place, all over the state. Marla has done dozens and dozens of presentations. I've done lots of presentations. We've also been doing something else that's I think really important. You know, we're thrilled when we look out at an audience like all of you and see people who care about these issues and who are willing to become more conversant themselves personally, so that when they visit with their family and their friends and their neighbors, that they can speak with authority and accuracy about our system, its good points, its weaker points, where we need to improve, etc. So we're thrilled to see that. But we appreciate that you can't do it by yourselves.
dream come true? A captive audience.
And one final question, is there any poll on retention? Have there been any polls as to how that's been fair?
We are not involved in.
Part of the issue for us is that we are non-partisan, so we cannot talk about a lot of issues. We can educate, but we can't do anything more than that. And so we personally are not involved in or have specific information on that. Evan Gates is here with Kansans for Fair Courts, which is a group that is helping support our retention effort. She can perhaps individually provide you some more information as there was physically.
Yes. We have had a lot of requests to see where we can get some.
Evan can help with that. Evan can give you advice on that too.
Women for Campus is an organization that has their things. So if you visit their website, there are links you can look on to go in your community.
Women for Kansas, right?
Yes.
Okay, that website. Then we've all been here about an hour. That's about the most amount of information anybody can absorb in one session. Any last questions before I call an adjournment? Yes, sir.
I think the Kansas legislature recently passed a law that said a person could be held in custody something like 150 days before or something. I don't know the particulars, but I do remember the 150 days. And I don't think I could survive in jail without 150 days without ESPN.
Many of us. I think what you read is that they had amended the statute concerning speeding trial, and that for a charge from the day you plead not guilty, the court has to bring you to trial within 150 days of that not guilty plea. That does not necessarily mean you're in jail. Most people actually are out on bond while they're awaiting those 150 days with their ESPN. So, that's true. That is absolutely true. There are a number of people who cannot pay a bondsman $50 for the $500 bond. Yeah, but actually here in Douglas County, we're really working on bond supervision, OR bonds with bond supervision, and not having to put money up front in order to get out of jail for a couple of reasons. It's more fair for many people. You shouldn't be in jail just because you're poor. And two, this Douglas County is paying $1 million a year to farm out people who are in custody in our Douglas County jail. So that is an unbelievable burden upon the taxpayers of Douglas County. So the courts, the sheriff, the county commission, everybody's really looking at that and trying to address that.
Thank you. I'm grateful.
Well, I'm ending up being there, but.
Does the Supreme Court have a limit on the size or number of pages or words that of a brief that can be filed?
The typical page limit on a brief by an attorney is 50 pages. They can file a motion to exceed the page limit and then individually consider whether it's necessary. But the conventional limit is 50 pages. I always say to people, they're called briefs, but they're not a brief. Thank you all.
And as to words, our oral arguments are traditionally 15 minutes aside, is what we allow the attorneys. Unfortunately, we're involved in that process, and we have a tendency to ask a lot of questions. So often, those arguments go more than that total of 30 minutes per case, but that would be a typical. Again, people can motion and file for more.
Thank you very much.